our heroes have ventured deep within the ruined tower. After scouting ahead, they find a group of zombies guarding the necromancer as they prepare some kind of blood ritual. Knowing that time is short, they rush in the battle. The rogue quickly darts behind a rock outcropping to hide, ready to ambush the nearest foe. The sorcerer quickly and powerfully weaves magic into a potent spell, and the barbarian charges in, swinging her great axe at all who dare to stand between her and the enemy. On today's D&D Academy, we're covering actions in combat. Welcome back. My name is Paul, and I'm the Dungeon Master here at House of Crit. Continuing our series on combat, we're going to cover actions. Actions are the specific things you can do on your turn in combat. When you take your action on your turn, you can take one of the actions presented here, an action you gained from a class or special feature, or an action that you improvise. Your character can do things not covered by actions in this video, such as breaking down doors, intimidating enemies, sensing weaknesses in magical defenses, or calling for a parley with a foe. The only limits to the actions you can attempt are your imagination and your character's ability scores. When you describe an action not detailed elsewhere in the rules, the DM tells you whether that action is possible and what kind of role you might need to make, if any, to determine success or failure. Now, let's get started with the most common action taken, the attack action. The attack action means you make an attack with a weapon. Whether you are swinging a sword, firing an arrow from a bow, or just brawling with your fists. With this action, you make one melee or ranged attack. Certain features, such as the extra attack feature of the fighter, allow you to make more than one attack with this one action. Now, the second most common action taken in combat is casting a spell. Spellcasters such as wizards and clerics have access to spells and can use them to great effect in combat. Each spell has a casting time, which specifies whether the caster must use an action, bonus action, reaction, minutes, or even hours to cast the spell. Casting a spell is therefore not necessarily an action. Most spells do have a casting time of one action, so a spellcaster often uses their action in combat to cast such a spell. We'll go into much greater detail on spellcasting, though, in a later video. There are a variety of other actions you can take other than attacking or casting a spell that provide a wide range of benefits. Sometimes you're too far away from the enemy, or far too close, and need more than just your base speed to get into position. In this instance, you can take the dash action. When you take the dash action, you gain extra movement for the current turn. The increase equals your speed after applying any modifiers. With a speed of 30 feet, for example, you could move up to 60 feet on your turn if you dash. However, any increase or decrease to your speed changes this additional movement by the same amount. If your speed of 30 feet is reduced to 15 feet, for instance, you can move up to 30 feet this turn if you dash. Speaking of being too close to the enemy, you could take the disengage action. If you take the disengage action, your movement does not provoke opportunity attacks for the rest of the turn. If moving away isn't an option, or you're in the middle of a fight in order to draw the attention of the enemies away from your allies and onto yourself, you could take the dodge action. When you take the dodge action, you focus entirely on avoiding attacks. Until the start of your next turn, any attack roll made against you has disadvantage if you can see the attacker, and you make dexterity saving throws with advantage. You lose this benefit if you are incapacitated or if your speed drops to zero. If you're drawing a blank on what to do on your turn, taking the dodge action is a good default action to take. Or if you want to aid your companions in battle, you could take the help action. When you take the help action, the creature you aid gains advantage on the next ability check it makes to perform the task you're helping with, provided that it makes the check before the start of your next turn. Alternatively, you could aid a friendly creature in attacking an enemy within 5 feet of you. You feint, distract the target, or in some other way team up to make the ally's attack more effective. If your ally attacks the target before your next turn, the first attack roll is made with advantage. Sometimes you may want to try to evade your enemies and take the hide action. When you take the hide action, you make a dexterity stealth check in attempt to hide. In order to do this, you do have to break your enemy's line of sight, but if you succeed, you gain certain benefits, such as possible advantage on your next attack. We'll detail this more in our upcoming special combat rules video. Now, two other actions you could take that are a little more utilitarian in nature are the search action and the use an object action. When you take the search action, you devote your attention to finding something. Depending on the nature of your search, the DM might have you make a wisdom perception check or an intelligence investigation check. Also, when an object requires your action for its use, you take the use an object action. This action is also useful when you want to interact with more than one object on your turn. The last type of action available is a little more detailed, and that is the ready action. Sometimes you want to get the jump on a foe or wait for a particular circumstance before you act. To do so, you can take the ready action on your turn so that you can act later in the round using your reaction. First, you decide what perceivable circumstance will trigger your reaction. Then, you choose the action you will take in response to that trigger, or you choose to move up to your speed in response to it. Examples include, if this cultist steps on this trapdoor, I'll pull the lever that opens it, or if the goblin steps through the doorway, I'll attack it. When the trigger occurs, you can either take your reaction right after the trigger finishes, or ignore the trigger. Remember that you can only take one reaction per round. You can also ready a spell. Doing so does require spending the spell slot resource to cast the spell. So whether or not you release the spell slot is used. Releasing the spell does also use your reaction, and maintaining the spell until you do uses your concentration. Spell slots and concentration are things we will take a much deeper dive on in a later video. And that's it for actions. Again, the only limit to what you can choose to do on your turn is your imagination, but these 10 actions handle most situations characters find themselves in, and so knowing them helps make more informed decisions in combat. Thank you so much for joining me today, and if this video helped you out, consider hitting the like and subscribe buttons down below, and possibly sharing these videos with your gaming groups. I'll be back next Wednesday with another D&D Academy video, this time covering damage and healing. See you soon.